Hello students, so I'll be taking this chapter, that is the cell signaling portion. So this chapter is very much important. So you are seeing this video as a kind of a video lecture. So now the thing which is important, first of all, that I'll be focusing on those topics which are actually essential for your, IIT JAM, yeah, TIFR or any kind of other computer examinations like GATB, all these kind of things. So we'll not go in very much greater details because questions will come from that portion only in your competitive exams, from which I'll be taking the points. And also important thing is that we'll focus on mainly 2-3 systems from where maximum questions and also the interviews will also come, but not other. This is a huge topic, so we'll not go into very much greater details. You can learn in your own, but for these competitive examinations, you don't need to know a lot. Yeah, before interview, we'll discuss for our interview session. We'll have some discussion sessions for the interview. We can discuss about that topics later, but for your competitive exams, we'll be mainly focusing on 2-3 portions of the cell signaling, which are very, very important. And the question will come from that section only, not from outside. First of all, which we'll be focusing first, that is the G protein coupled receptors. So first of all, we'll be focusing on the G protein coupled receptors, right? So you have a basic understanding of this receptor. You have studied about this receptor in your BSc, right? So obviously in second year or third year you have learned about this. The first point, this is also known as GPCR. This is also known as what? GPCR. Now first of all, the important point you have to know that there is a word called the G protein. There is a word known as G protein. Okay, so we'll take a short full form of this G protein. G protein is nothing but the guanine. I'll take a bigger ink, I think that will be better. G protein is basically, So G protein is basically guanine nucleotide. Guanine nucleotide binding protein. So these G proteins, we have discussed about the G proteins in our cell biology lectures. So we have already discussed that those proteins which has a tendency to bind with the GTP, guanine nucleotide. So these actually binds with, has a tendency to bind with GTP and also bind with the GDP, right? It can either bind with GTP or GDP. These G proteins which are actually present, these G proteins which we are actually now talking about, another important criteria is that these G proteins which are here, they are normally of two types. So G proteins can be of two types, okay? So there can be smaller G proteins. So we have discussed about the smaller G proteins in our cell biology lectures. We have talked about RAS, we have talked about RAN, okay? We have talked about SAR1, right? We have already talked about all this kind of smaller G protein. RAS is associated with the RAS-MAP kinase pathway. This RAN protein is involved in the nuclear export and import. SAR1 helps in the particular from COP2 coating, right? We have talked about all these kind of things. Now, another type of G proteins are also present. These are the larger G proteins. And these larger G proteins, we'll be talking about these kind of proteins over here. And they are mainly heterotrimeric. They are mainly heterotrimeric. So means they will have three monomers and they are not the same. So suppose this is one monomer, right? I'll make another monomer in another ring. Suppose this is another monomer. Suppose this is another monomer and another monomer will be like this. Suppose this will be another monomer. Okay. Like this. So suppose this is a one monomer, this is another monomer, this is another monomer. So in this heterotrimer, this is the G alpha subunit. This will be the G beta subunit. These are the monomers, right? And this is the G gamma subunit. why it's called trimeric, because three monomers are present, and why it is known as, why it is calling, why we are calling it as a hetero, because these three monomers are not identical, they are different, right? And the receptors which we'll be talking about, these receptors, the GPCR, so the G protein coupled receptors, so this R stands for the receptors, right? So this receptors, these G protein coupled receptors, they are also known as serpentine receptor, also known as serpentine receptors, okay? They're also known as metabotropic receptors, also known as metabotropic receptors, right? These things are very easy, I guess. Okay, very good. Now let's go to the structure of this GPCR. Okay. So structure. Now, in this structure, this PC is also known as 7-pass membrane receptor. We have mentioned it in the cell biology classes. Membrane receptors. Very good. Now, what is happening? First of all, the structure is important. So if you draw the structure, so it will be like kind of this. Suppose this is the membrane. Suppose this is the membrane. I am drawing the membrane over like this. And the receptor will be present somewhat like, so suppose this is the domain where it is binding with the ligands. Suppose this is the domain where it is binding with the ligands. So I'll just take another ink. So this is the domain, and it is actually passing the membrane 7 times. So this is 1 time, 2 times. So 1, 2. Now it will come again down, and then up, then down, then up, and then like this. So how this is 7-pass receptor? We'll see that. This is 1 time. This is 2nd time. This is 3rd time. This is 4th time it's passing, this is 5th time it's passing, this is 6th time it's passing, and now this is the 7th time it has passed. So that's why it is known as the 7-pass spanning membrane receptors. And these domains of the protein, these domains which we are seeing over here, we have studied about that majorly in case of that which is actually the membrane spanning portions. They are mainly, have we secondary structure? Yes. They're having the alpha helix. They're having the alpha helix. This domain, this portion, I'll just take a different thing so that it will be easier for you. So this portion which I have mentioned over here, this portion like this is the ligand binding site. So this is the ligand binding domain. So this domain is the ligand binding domain. Very good. So I'm going from basic level. Now I will just pull up after some times. So this is the ligand binding domain. Okay. And here, which is present like this. So I have just drawn a particular schematic diagram, right? So this is the ligand binding site. That will be the best word. And here, over in this region, these G trimeric, heterotrimeric proteins, they will actually bind. So these heterotrimeric proteins, they will actually bind like this. So I'll just take different things to draw that. So these are the heterotrimeric proteins. Suppose like, okay. These are the heterotrimeric proteins. So suppose this is the G alpha, G beta, and G gamma. This is the heterotrimeric protein. And normally when this particular protein, and when there is no ligand, first of all, there is no ligand. So in this condition, there is no ligand. Then here this is bound with the GDP. Then it is bound with GDP, right? Now when ligand binds, when ligand actually binds over here, when the ligand actually binds over here, this is the supposed ligand, and suppose it actually binds over here. So suppose let the ligand is now binding. Now what will happen? then it will be bound with this GDP will be removed, and this GDP will be actually removed and GDP will come. So GDP will come and the GDP will be removed. So what will happen? It will be like this, GDP will be removed and this GDP will come and bind with the G alpha protein, right? And we'll discuss about all these kind of things, what will happen later, we'll discuss about that. But now let's focus on this ligand. This ligand is very important. So now let's, our topic will be, so this is the ligand. So now, what are the basic ligands for the GPCR? We'll be discussing about those things. So let's take this over here and let's discuss about this ligand, right? Now, ligand can be, these ligands can be visual sensory ligands, okay? So visual sensory ligands, right? Like rhodopsin. Like what? Rhodopsin. Okay. Now we have also we'll also study that this GPCR, G protein coupled receptors, these olfactory receptors or the pheromone receptors, these are also the G protein coupled receptors. Taste. So visual sensory ligands, this is the rhodopsin, they also have a GPCR. In taste, they also have a GPCR involved, right? In now, epinephrine is one of the important, that is the adrenaline, this is one of the important ligands. Glucagon, in taste sensation, we don't have to know about what is the important ligand, but you just have to know that in taste sensation also this GPCR is involved. And epinephrine is one of the important ligand. Glucagon is another important ligand, glucagon, right? Serotonin, this is an important ligand, okay? And antidiuretic hormone, ADH, this is another important. So they can ask a question like, the ADH receptor is what kind of a receptor? This is nothing but a GPCR or the serpentine or the seven pass membrane spanning receptors, right? ACTH is also another important ligand, right? Now first of all, we'll be discussing this kind of mechanism of this GPCR by different phases. So we'll be discussing about the signal transduction process. So let's move on to the signal transduction. So we'll be now discussing about the signal transduction. It's an important area. This is very important. First point, there will be, first, there will be an activation of the enzyme. There will be activation of certain kind of enzyme. So first of all, this is the membrane, and suppose if I draw this, this is the ligand binding site and this is the GPCR, this is the, suppose the GPCR, and this G alpha, G beta and G gamma subunits are present over here. And when the ligand comes, what happens? This G alpha binds with the GTP and it will actually now activate different certain kinds of enzymes, membrane spanning enzymes. So we'll be discussing about these kind of enzymes. So what happens when the ligand binds with the receptor? Then this G alpha binds with the GTP and it gets dissociated, and it gets dissociated with the G alpha subunits. So it gets dissociated with the G alpha's other beta and gamma subunits, and this G alpha with the GTP bound form, it actually comes and binds with a different enzyme. As a result of that, it activates certain enzymes. First of all, you need to know, the first process will be the activation of the enzymes. Activation of the enzymes. Now, what kind of enzymes we need to know? First point. First, adenylyl cyclase. My process or way of explaining thing will be, in one time, at the same time, I will cover everything regarding the GPCR. So adenylyl cyclase, right? Adenylyl cyclase. one kind of enzyme will be adenylyl cyclase. This is also represented at AC. Another important enzyme is phosphodiesterase. What? Phosphodiesterase. Another important enzyme is phospholipase C. Phospholipase C, we'll see that another kind of, so this is C beta, that is better. Different secondary messengers, so when it gets activated, there are different secondary messengers. I need not to explain you what is a secondary messenger. Okay, hormones are the primary messengers and there are other important messengers. Then the secondary messenger, we have studied about different secondary messengers in our BSc or in class 11 and 12. Calcium 2 plus connector, the secondary messenger, CAMP, IP3, DAG, these are the secondary messengers. So activation of secondary messenger will be also there over here. So I will just giving you all the data of the secondary messengers. Right? What kind of secondary messengers? So there can be CAMP pathway, cyclic AMP, this is a secondary messenger. So there will be a CAMP pathway. And there can be IP3 DAG pathway. We'll also discuss about all these kind of things in the later part of the video. Now, different ion channels are also involved over in these GPCR signal transductions, right? Different ion channels are also involved. So involvement or the linked ion channels. So they will actually activate different ion channels, or they will open different ion channels, close different ion channels. So linked ion channels is also important. So they can be sodium plus channels, there can be potassium ion channels, K plus ion channels, and there can be calcium 2 plus ion channels. Okay, very good. So now we'll discuss about the regulation part. We'll discuss about the regulation of the GPCR. So let's move on to the regulation. Okay. So now, regulation of G proteins. Regulation of G proteins. Very good. First of all, let me draw the membrane first. So you just have to see this lecture like I'm going from a very basic level so that you get understand all the concepts. So I'm not doing this serpentine wala thing. I'll just make a 3D version. So here there will be actually different passing, but I am not actually focusing over here. I am just drawing a 3D diagram. Right. So these are the different domains. These are the different domains. This is actually the ligand binding domain. This is the ligand binding domain. This one is the G protein binding domain. This one is the G protein binding domain. And this one is the membrane spanning domain. This one is the membrane spanning domain, right? So suppose what happens normally when it is an inactive state. So suppose signal is absent. When there is absence of the signal, then this is the cytosol. And suppose this is the outside and this is the membrane, okay? And this is the membrane. So just like this, okay? Now, normally what happens, these heterotrimers are actually present, remain bound with this, okay, one second, yeah, they remain bound with this, and this total complex remain bound like this. So this is the G alpha. Suppose this is G alpha, this is beta, and this is gamma, and it remains bound with the GTB bound form. This is the normal case. Now suppose there is a signal. Now when there is a signal, suppose now signal is present, and suppose this is the ligand. It binds with the ligand binding site. Now when it binds with the ligand binding site, so what happens? What happens is that this, it was present in the GTP bound form, not GTP, I'm really sorry. Normally it was present in GTP bound form, but when there is signal presence, there will be a guanine exchange nucleotide factor. So one GEF will be coming along with the GTP, and it will release the GDP, and as a result of that you will find that there will be GTP over here. And when there will be GTP over here, the thing which will happen, this G protein will be activated. So when this alpha, beta, and this is the gamma, when it is bound with the GTP, now we will call this is an activated G protein. This is known as an activated G protein, right? Now what is actually happening? This is known as activated G protein. Now what will happen? There will be a dissociation of, the G alpha GTP. So there will be dissociation of G alpha GTP. Okay, right. So when this will be dissociated, so I'll just draw here. Okay. So this is the G alpha GTP will be dissociated. Now what will happen? This dissociated G alpha GTP, it will now actually target different enzymes and it will activate certain ion channels. So we will discuss about what kind of enzymes will it target, what kind of ion channels will it target under the specific sections of different GPCR systems, right? And after its work is done, after this G alpha GTP, this activated G alpha GTP which is present, so this will actually target different enzymes. So we'll see that it will target different adenylyl cyclase, it will actually activate the cyclic AMP pathway, and we'll see that the cyclic AMP will activate different protein kinases, and that protein kinases will actually help in the opening of different ion channels and all. So yeah, it will target different enzymes, okay, and this will support, this is adenylyl cyclase, and it will actually help in the ATP to CMP production. This CMP production is nothing but the secondary messengers cycle, and this CMP which is present, it will activate a particular different protein kinases, and this protein kinase, suppose protein kinase A can be there, C can be there, but suppose protein kinase A is there, and this will actually activate different kinds of ion channels, different sodium plus ion channels, potassium plus ion channels. So it will close potassium ion, open sodium ion, okay, open calcium 2 plus ion, these ion channels will be opened or closed, okay. So that is the case, or that is the scenario over here. Now the point which we need to know, that after this all activity is being performed, then again what will happen, there will be a particular GTPase activity. So again a GTPase will come, okay, a GTPase activity will be there, and as a result of that, the G alpha subunit, it will again bound with the GDP, and the PI will be removed. So from this GTP, PI will be removed, and again it will be back to the GTP. This is important, okay. So this GTPase is also known as gaps. We have studied about gaps. This is the GTPase activating peptide, and that is also an important thing. This is the GTPase activating peptide, and this GTPase activating peptide which is present over here, this is actually activated when all the work is done. This is actually activated by a protein known as the RGS protein. Okay, you don't need to know all these kind of things, but I'm just telling you that how this GTPase is actually regulated. The regulator of this GTPase, or the GTPase activating peptide, is RGS protein is actually activating this GTPase activating peptide, which in turn, by the help of this GTPase activity, converts the G alpha GTP to the G alpha GDP. Okay, so this RGS, the full form of this protein is very easy. This is RGS stands for regulator of G protein. Regulator of G protein. Okay, so that is the scenario, and as a result of that, there will be a GTP hydrolysis, and again, it will be becoming into the normal case, and it will be again GGP. It will be again GTP. So that is all the case which is happening, which is taking place. So this is the basic scenario of the G protein coupled receptors. So questions might come from here. Okay. So in the next video, I'll be discussing about the types. So this was a general introduction video of the cell signaling lectures. So in the next video, it will be a long video. We'll be discussing about the types of the G protein coupled receptor and what are the role of different toxins, how it actually regulates the different processes in the signal and transduction pathway of the G protein. We'll be discussing in the next video, and after that there'll be another video regarding the another of in the next video it will be our G protein coupled receptor will be completed, and there'll be a third video where we'll be discussing about the receptor tyrosine kinase pathway. Okay, so there will be either three videos or four videos, and we'll complete the total cell signaling into 3 to 4 lectures. All right, so this was a short introduction video. In the next lecture, we'll be discussing about the types of the GPCR, or the types of different G alpha subunits. There can be stimulatory subunits, there can be inhibitory subunits, there can be transducer subunits, all different G alpha T, G alpha S, G alpha I, all these kind of G alpha proteins we'll be discussing in the next video. And we'll also discuss about the regulation of the glycogen metabolism by the help of epinephrine mediated by this G protein coupled receptor. So it will be a very important video in the next. So please write your own notes, make your notes, and now let's move on to the next lecture. Just click on that and now see the next part. Okay, thank you so much. Meet you in the next lecture. Bye bye.